Hello and welcome to How to Win the Lottery, Season 10 of Vermont, Book 1, The Shame by makenna Goodman. I'm Joey Lewandowski.
I am Shreds, and a very happy Halloween to you.
We are in the middle of September. I was just saying to Shreds that a future episode we recorded, I'm just like, it's Halloween. It's no longer Halloween, so I was a week off my calendar. But happy Halloween.
Happy Halloween. In our hearts. Are you one of those Halloween guys? I don't know anything about
it. Are you one of those Halloween guys?
Yeah, you know, like, I know you're not like one of those guys that, like, you don't have like a Jack Skellington hoodie or anything like that. But, like, although it wouldn't be out of your character to have like a Jack Skellington shirt that has some Japanese writing on it.
I don't really care about the movie one way or the other, but when Phoebe was doing the live thing in London, I was just like,
This is Phoebe Bridgers that we're talking about.
I'm not a Jack Skellington guy. I'm not a This is Halloween guy. I like horror movies, but that's about as far as it gets.
Yeah. Yeah.
There's always like a pressure to have a costume.
What's a memorable costume that you've had?
When I was in elementary school, I won a costume contest. Maybe I was like in preschool.
Yeah. Lee Harvey Oswald.
Yeah.
Knew it.
He was really good. No, yeah. I was
Jack Ruby one year, so.
Clark Kent and Superman. I was Superman underneath and Clark Kent, and then I just like peeked the shirt. It was a shirt and I had a little reporter.
That's because your dad's a Superman guy. Oh man. These parents, they really like.
But happy Halloween to all of our listeners.
Yeah, happy Halloween to all of you.
100% the first Vermont book that we have read and covered and recorded.
Shit. I forgot that we're doing things out of order.
Because you started reading the next book. So like at some point in this episode, you have to vow to drink a gallon of maple syrup.
Is that something I talk about in the next thing?
Well, I asked how it was going next episode.
Okay. Well,
that's the only callback we set up in the next episode.
But between this episode and the next episode, I will drink a gallon of maple syrup.
I got some Vermont facts.
Yeah, let's hear them.
So next time, spoiler, we'll talk about famous Vermonters, Vermonteers, and Vermonters.
Vermountaineers.
I got some basic stuff. I like to start off these state modules with like some basic Vermont facts. Do you know what number state it was?
14th.
14th. First one after the colonies. Do you know its nickname? I believe
Is it the Green Mountain State?
It is.
Yeah.
I believe they mentioned it a couple times in the next book. Do you know the capital of Vermont?
Is it Burlington?
Nope. That's the biggest town.
Montpellier?
Montpellier.
Yeah.
Montpellier.
Is that it?
Small state capital in the U.S., yep.
Yeah.
The only U.S. capital without a McDonald's.
Oh, all right. Well, Bill McKibben would love that.
Became the first of four states. This is in 1968.
By the way, I'm doing really well.
You are doing really well.
Yeah, I'm doing really well with my Vermont knowledge right now.
In 1968, Vermont was the first of four states to ban billboards.
That's awesome.
Do you know the three other states that have banned billboards?
Is it like New Hampshire? And
no, there's one that's close. There's one that's like, follow that train of thought. There's
Maine.
Maine.
And maybe Montana?
Mm-mm. But it's similar-ish.
North Dakota?
Mm-mm.
South Dakota?
Mm-mm.
Oregon?
Mm-mm.
Idaho?
Mm-mm.
Wyoming?
Mm-mm.
Fuck, I don't know.
Alaska.
Okay.
And Hawaii.
All right.
Apparently have all banned billboards. How many area codes do you think are in Vermont?
Four.
One.
Wow.
They're all 802.
Holy shit.
Do you know what states border Vermont? Canada is its northern border. Three states.
Sure. New York, Maine, New Hampshire?
New York, New Hampshire, and...
Connecticut? Massachusetts?
Massachusetts.
Yeah, that's what I meant. Because Connecticut's below Massachusetts, so...
Largest city, Burlington. You guessed that before. Population about 45,000. It is number 49 in the state. Number 49 in population, 43 in land area. We'll talk about that more in the next episode. First state in the country to legally recognize same-sex couples?
Yeah.
Lead producer of maple syrup in the U.S.?
Seems obvious.
I'm gonna give you different numbers. I want you to guess how much maple syrup it produced. This says 2024, so I don't know if this is to date.
Yeah.
Do you think it is 300,000 gallons, 3 million gallons, or 30 million gallons?
300,000 gallons.
3.1 million gallons.
Holy fuck. That's too many. It's too many gallons of maple syrup.
Has more than 500 dairy farms on more than 900,000 acres of land.
Mm-hmm.
124,000 cows in Vermont.
Wow.
And the final fact, it leads the nation in breweries per capita with 58 breweries as of last year.
These are all like Bill McKibben facts. Mm-hmm. Like he would be really happy to hear you saying all this.
There is one sort of correction I will say to the next episode. There are apparently two presidents from Vermont. And I don't remember who they were. I didn't write it down. But it was,
well, one was Calvin Coolidge.
Yeah, that's the one I remember.
That's the one that I got.
McKinley, maybe?
Yeah, sure.
Sounds something. Right. Anyway, we're talking about The Sheen by McKenna Goodman, our first Vermont book.
How can you shape this as a Vermont novel for me?
I was making notes of, does this feel Vermont?
Yeah.
I think it feels Vermont the most when she is in New York.
It's in like the first couple sentences of, yes. of the book. She's yes. like, I'm here in Vermont.
I think it's her fish out of waterness of being in New York City, of being in Brooklyn, that just like, oh, this is not home.
Yeah.
I also think, and this is maybe a stereotypical Vermont thing, but the job offer she gets for like an ethical toy manufacturer, I'm like, that's some Vermont ass shit there. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Yeah. It's interesting to see the ways in which Vermont sort of, there's like a Venn diagram of Vermont and Williamsburg, you know?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And like Vermont, like it obviously feels like the more authentic version of those things. Yeah. The way that like
Williamsburg
Portland is the more authentic version of like that hip, like hipster culture.
Yeah.
Like once you end up in like people in Brooklyn with the fucking,
well, they're trying to have that, but also live in a place with like concerts and stuff.
In Brooklyn, when people have handlebar mustaches, you're just like, ugh, come on. Mm-hmm. You're just like doing that thing that they're doing over there.
It's like, oh, there's a mean guy with a mustache like that.
Yeah.
Yeah. But other than that, like, I think this is one of the books sort of like Sunburn,
mm-hmm.
where it's like, it's just kind of it's where the book happens.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
It's not a bad thing.
No. And I think it's interesting that I think it does play into, you know, we got a bunch of facts about Vermont and the isolation of it. And that sort of, I think that plays into it a little bit, that it's not like she lacks community. If you take it by, I hate to keep on bringing up Bill McKibben, but if you take it by his mm-hmm. thing, it's like Vermont is a very neighborly place.
Sure.
So if you lack community there because of the isolation, maybe it's a you problem.
Mm. I also think that there is, if she were in Brooklyn, I think there would be more acceptance. This is not exactly what you're saying, but it's related, like it's tangentially related, where it's, if she's like, I don't want to be a mom, I want to be a blank.
Yeah.
In Brooklyn, be like, do it. But in Vermont, it's like, no, you're a mom.
Yeah, there's more like, quote unquote, maybe traditional values mm-hmm. in Vermont.
Because this is a book about a woman who effectively is tired of being a mom, sort of falls in love with or becomes enamored by an influencer, or maybe just the normal person she finds on Instagram.
Mm-hmm. Which is a person that she's kind of created too.
Yep. And she leaves her family to go try to figure out what, not a relationship, but like not like a sexual relationship, but be like, what would it be like if this person were in her life?
Mm-hmm.
That's kind of what it is.
Mm-hmm. And she's also a artist. She's a writer
and a painter
and she is trying to deal with this idea that being a mother and a wife does not feel like her authentic self,
mm-hmm.
that her authentic self has these high art ideals mm-hmm. for who she is. And so when she has the opportunity to like write and make money doing it, it's for this like hyper commercialized thing that she doesn't really want to do, even though she has fun doing it. But she doesn't want to do it because it's sort of compromising who she is as an artist. And she doesn't see why her husband gets to do the thing that he wants to do and feel fulfilled about it,
mm-hmm.
where she has to stay at home
right.
and lose so much of herself to both being a wife and a husband. Even though there is a part in the book where she talks about how her husband, what is he? He's like, we'll do my thing for however, and then whenever you feel like it, we can just do a switch.
But it becomes clear that like that's never gonna, the switch is never going to
which
come.
I think is
probably common.
That's the game, right? Yeah. Like, and then when the switch comes, it's like, oh, do you really want to like start over?
Look at everything you have here. You're such a good mom.
Do you want to start over in a small apartment where we don't have any money with this kid and yeah. take her away from her friends and like start life over again? No, nobody wants that. So it's like saying like the first 5 years are for me and then the next 5 years can be for you is really saying the whole time is going to be for me.
Yep.
Right. But that is something that the novel is confronting as and confronts Asa, that's the husband's name.
Right? It's Alma and Asa. Her name only mentioned like two or three times in very brief passing.
Asa is engaging in a kind of male privilege where he gets to be a good guy. He gets to be like the nice guy, the caring guy, but also like through his.
Also the provider and the well-respected member of the community, like the collegiate community.
Yeah. But like in. So there's like a facade of deniability, right? Like he's not denying her who she is. He's in some ways encouraging her to be who, like he can be as encouraging as he wants. But like, I don't know if there's a way for him to like quote unquote win at this, but everything that he's doing is still slowly like stripping her identity away from her. She has to lose herself in social media, which I think is something that a lot of us do, right? By sort of attaching herself to personalities that aren't hers and imagining her life in these circumstances, imagining friends that aren't friends, imagining like what her day looks like if she didn't have these things, if she weren't tied down in this way. You had compared it to A Touch of Gin,
which we did in the internet module.
Elaborate on that. Because I have another comparison.
Yeah, where a young woman finds like an influencer that she becomes obsessed with and models herself after. And sort of injects herself into this person's life.
Yeah.
And then it sort of devolves from there into some craziness. But I think it struck me as seeing someone who seems to have it all on Instagram and being like, not necessarily I want their life, but also like their life seems glamorous. I wish my life was more like that.
Yeah. Which is interesting. You mentioned that to me when I hadn't even started reading the book yet. And you had messaged me and said like, oh, this is giving me A Touch of Gin vibes. And when I read it, I thought it reminded me a lot of Nightbitch.
Which we also covered.
The Rachel Yoder novel.
Adaptable.
Because that book is also about like a woman losing herself, losing her sense of identity to her family.
A mother feeling trapped.
Yeah, but that novel is much more triumphant in that she does take that the animalistic side of her and engages in it in a way that ends up making really good art, whereas the narrator in this novel doesn't do that.
It seems like she starts to, like, she, as she's putting the kids to sleep, she has like an hour while she can't really get up because her son or daughter is falling asleep, and if she moves to start the whole thing over again. And so she has like this hour to like fill with her imagination. She's like, this is the only time of the day that like I feel like myself because I have like time to myself. And she starts writing stories or imagining stories and then like rushing to write them down and starts like writing a thing. And then that's just sort of becomes imagining what Celeste, this woman in Brooklyn who seems to have it all.
Yeah.
What her life must be like.
So Celeste also exists in this place where she is sort of there is a name for it. Like demonic or spiritual double that I'm blanking on what it's called. But so
Avatar? No.
No, not, it is not an avatar, but although I guess she exists as an avatar for the freedoms and all the things that she doesn't want. But our narrator creates Celeste into this person that she wants to be.
Mm-hmm.
It becomes very weird when she starts stalking her and following her around. And stuff like
that. Well, it feels like, oh, this has become a thriller, but there's also, she realizes and you realize, oh, Celeste does not know what this woman looks like.
Yeah.
And so she like goes to Brooklyn. She like emails Celeste to say, I've been following your journey online. I think it'd be a great nanny for your kids. Like I have like all this experience, blah, blah, blah. And like, there's this thing, like, is she going to abandon her children to basically caretake for another woman's children?
It's an interesting thing to say, like, I need a change of pace in my life.
I'm going
to
do the same thing,
I'm going to do the same thing, but in service of someone else.
Well, I also thought, like, in this moment, and this is also spoilers from it, I can't really – it's like Tully.
Yeah, I thought that too, actually.
where, spoilers for Tully, where, you know, Charlize Theron hires this nanny, but it's really just her as a younger person. She's imagining, like, getting help from her younger self.
And is also fulfilling her husband's sexual needs and stuff like that in a way that is maybe not the most feminist thing.
And I
ever,
think
ever committed to screen.
And I think, well, that's the Reitman Juno, Reitman Diablo Cody thing.
I think, again, it's more complicated than that.
No, it's not. I also think it's a good movie.
I'm not. I actually like Diablo Cody quite a bit as a writer.
I even saw Paradise. Nobody saw Paradise.
the Russell Brand vehicle Paradise. Right, that's a Russell Brand movie.
It's Kristen. It's behind you on the shelf. You can.
You own the film Paradise.
I believe that's so.
That's a step. That's a bridge too far.
Wait, maybe I don't.
This is not important.
No, now I'm curious. But keep going.
And how does the book end?
Well,
because we're already kind of at the end here.
Yeah. Well, so she goes to Brooklyn because Celeste gets back to him and is like, oh my God, this seems perfect. Like, let's meet up. And so the book starts at the end where she is driving to somewhere. It's like
having abandoned her children.
It feels like, oh, she's like starting a new life, but it's just like she's driving from Vermont down to Brooklyn a couple hours. Mm-hmm. And she is just like stomping around Celeste's neighborhood and then accidentally literally runs into Celeste.
Yeah.
But Celeste does not know who she is. And it seems like she's very clearly fish out of water. And then she gets like knocked out cold trying to chase her down, like slips and falls and hits her head and like gets knocked out cold on the subway. And then she's like, well, I guess this is fun, but I got to go home.
Yeah. Well, when she gets knocked down, I'm trying to make this intertextual. When she like kind of crashes into Celeste, right?
Yes.
So there is this sense there in that.
But Celeste does not stop. She just keeps going.
But Celeste is her double. And so like we have this idea that doubles out in the world, like doubles making contact with each other, causes like the erasure of identity or the blankness, the explosion of one. It's sort of, maybe that's thematic to Dostoevsky's The Double.
Well, there's also like the thing in like time travel movies or like alternate dimensions, like don't touch yourself. Like if you touch yourself, like you're both going to get erased.
Yeah, yeah. So I think that's kind of what's going on here too. Like she wakes up and it's like, okay, now that dream is dead. And I no longer, like, this person has disappeared.
Yep.
Because I get the sense, I mean, I was thinking throughout the novel, I wasn't thinking that it was like realistic. I wasn't thinking of it as a realistic novel. I was thinking of it as that Celeste was not.
It was like an emotional journey or something.
That Celeste was a symbol, not a real thing or person, something that was a creation. And this creation exists as a double of Olm. Is that her name?
Alma.
Alma? Mm-hmm. Alma. What's the title about? Why is it called The Shame?
I mean, I think it's like the titular shame is like the societal thing that, like, I also, for the record, do not own Paradise.
Good. Glad we cleared that up.
That's the shame that I don't own Paradise. No, I think the shame is that you have done this thing that, like, society is like, for, you know, in a patriarchal society, like, woman's job is to marry and bear children and raise those children.
Right.
And I think the shame here is, I don't want that life. And, like, creating that and then leaving it.
The shame is her abandoning her.
I think so.
Her child.
Is it? Or do you see a different?
No. That's what I think it is too.
Yeah.
I feel like we've read a lot of books about motherhood.
Yeah.
Is that true? Like, I think Ducks Newburyport, specifically Nightbitch. Maybe there's not that many books about motherhood.
There's probably more.
Yeah.
I thought this was gonna be a different book when I started, because like the opening thing was like her.
It's very like fantastical.
And it's very funny. Like the book is not funny, but it's way funnier in this opening thing where she's like imagining she's on, like, there's like a growing pool of lava that you have to sprint and like outside. And again, it's a metaphor, but like
she's shooting down birds and stepping on their corpses.
Right. And outside of the pool of lava, there is like endless supply of like pasta salad or whatever, pasta and salad, whatever. And it's just, I think it's always like the grass is always greener. But I'm like, is this going to be like a weird book?
That was the book that you wanted? You wanted like a big weird?
No, I just, so when we last recorded, this is the next episode, we were talking about how the last module, the eco module, was so depressing. And Radio Free Vermont is an easier read. And then you were saying, without either of us having started this book, with a title like this, it's probably going to be a little bit bleaker.
Yeah.
So I was expecting kind of like a downer of a book, which it kind of is. It's not uber depressing, but it's not.
I was expecting the Steve McQueen movie Shame, Like I was just like not like I wasn't expecting
like Fassbender hanging dong.
I wasn't expecting the Steve McQueen movie to be like an adaptation of this, but I was expecting that level of bleakness.
Mm.
Like when you title your novel out of one of like the principally harrowing emotions, right?
Sure.
Shame is one of the things that we all deal with and like causes arguably like maybe shapes our personality more than almost anything else. I mean, if you have a therapist, like shame, I think is one of the main things that you're talking with about your therapist about. If theoretically, not that I would ever see a therapist. So I was expecting it to be a little bleaker than this, but also we're like culturally, this is not a dig at McKenna Goodman.
Mm-hmm.
This is not a dig at McKenna Goodman. Culturally, we're in a much, much more relaxed place about accepting this idea of a woman
wanting more than just motherhood.
Wanting more than just motherhood. Then we would have been 10, 15, 20, 30, 40, 50 years ago. If this book came out in 1950, it would have been like, holy fuck. Like, what a novel. And now it's like this is an accurate representation of a thing that I think a lot of people feel, but it's also an accurate representation of a thing that a lot of people have said.
Sure.
So this is like a shame that exists, but now it's a collective shame mm-hmm. that many people feel, and that if you express this shame, there is going to be an army of people that are like, fuck you, get back in the kitchen, da da da. But they're also going to have a number of people that are going to relate to it and not mm-hmm. relate to it quietly. This right. Like if you release this book in 1950, I guarantee there would be a ton of women that would read and go like, mm-hmm. fuck yes, but you probably
never say anything.
Like
yeah.
most of them would. So that idea,
and they also probably wouldn't be like allowed to buy the book or like be seen reading the book.
Yeah. So that idea of shame is like this book. The shame of this book is much easier to bear, which is like such a snotty thing for me to say as a dude that will never have to face this, what she's going through. So I'm not, that's not a dig. I'm not saying that it's like, whatever. I'm just saying that like, this is an interesting time to express that shame, because now you will have a ton of people that come to your side. And that doesn't mean there aren't going to be a ton of people that are still out there trying to like get you to go trad wife or whatever that shit is. Fuck those people forever. They can, suck a fart out of my, you know, where farts come from.
Mm-hmm. There's also the chance that the shame is just like Instagram addiction.
Yeah.
I don't think it's compelling, but I'm just thinking of other things. I'm looking back at books we've covered to talk about motherhood.
Yeah.
Fever Dream, kind of motherhood.
Uh-huh.
More
sure.
other stuff, but also motherhood. I mentioned earlier, Sunburn is kind of like, she packs up and leaves. Like that's the novel there. Book of Unknown Americans is partially about motherhood. Nightbitch, of course. H-Mart kind of, but like in reverse, but also kind of.
It's more about daughterhood.
And then going back to earlier, there's more for sure. But like, there's a handful of like things that like, yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know that a book about pool of lava shooting down birds with a bow and arrow that I could have or whatever to get an unlimited pasta and salad, soup, salad, and breadsticks, whatever. I don't know if it's the book I want, but I was worried about something really super uber bleak and being like, oh, this is not what I expected.
Yeah.
And then like, it doesn't really go back to that.
Yeah.
So.
Right.
So I don't know, like your question, like, is that the book you want? I'm like, I don't think so, but I also.
You were relieved to have that be the start of the book.
Mm-hmm. Another Trump era book. The next book will be a Trump era, but talking about kids in cages and her kids being like, is that going to happen to me? And she's mm-hmm. like, no, I mean, probably not, but no, we never know.
Yeah. Like, I find that kind of like, I cringe a little with Trump books. When people mention Trump directly, well, I'm always kind of like, it feels like easy pickings here.
When he got elected in 2016, I was like, this is going to inspire a wave of amazing
art. I think a lot of people thought that.
And it didn't.
Yeah.
Instead, what we just got was anger, which, you know, justified, but like Broad City, for instance, like saying his name but bleeping it out, I'm just like, this is just, it feels lazy. It just feels like there are better ways to like express disappointment or something, frustration.
And also like it also always feels to me like the mentioning of Trump in books,
which I don't know that his name is mentioned, but like stuff he did is mentioned.
It almost never feels like legitimate critique of him, it always feels like a wink, wink, hey, reader, we're on the same side here, right?
Yep.
Which is not, honestly, not something that I'm looking for in art. I don't need that.
I was surprised at the end of the book when we catch back up to the beginning and she is driving to Brooklyn. She doesn't have a plan. Mm-hmm. Like, her husband's frantically calling her, texting her, emailing her, whatever. But she's going to coffee shops, clothing stores, and ostensibly just using her credit card.
Yeah.
So he would know exactly where she is. And she's not really trying to start a new life.
Right.
Or maybe that's the point. Like, she never actually intended to.
For sure.
Right?
Yeah. I don't even think about stuff like that because I don't think of, like.
But you just think about, like, in that kind of story where somebody's like, I'm starting a new life. They go to the ATM. Yeah. They get out the maximum amount of cash they can get. And, like, I'll figure the rest out later.
Yeah.
But here, I mean, I think she paid for it because, like, there's the scene where she spills the coins on the ground at the coffee shop and she's very embarrassed and whatever. But she's not paying for this $150 sweater or whatever in cash. Like, she's probably charging it. So I'm just thinking about, like, this type of story, this type of trope just maybe goes to show she didn't actually intend to.
Tulpa was the word that I was thinking of before.
Tulpa.
I'm not 100% sure that that's the right word. I may be using it incorrectly.
T-O-L-P-A?
T-U-L-P-A.
T-U, like mea culpa. Is it Latin?
I don't know.
Tulpa?
You Googling?
In Tibetan Buddhism and later traditions of mysticism and paranormal, a tulpa is a materialized being or thought form, typically in human form, created through spiritual practice and intense concentration.
I nailed it. That's exactly what I meant.
A type of willed imaginary friend.
You see?
Influenced by depictions in television.
I am so goddamn smart.
And cinema from the 90s and 2000s. Is there an X-Files about tulpa? It feels like that's a thing that, like...
There probably is, yeah. There probably is.
Scully, it's a classic tulpa.
Yeah.
She's like, what do you mean, Mulder?
Yeah, that's probably how I learned about it.
Tulpa X-Files. There's one. The Ubermensch from the X-Files episode Arcadia is a tulpa. Uh-huh.
See, I'm a dick. That's one of my favorite episodes, too. That is 100% how I know what a tulpa is.
In Home Again, the Band-Aid Nose Man is also one. Curiously, in Home Again, Mulder claims tulpa. I think Home Again is a reboot episode. Because there's Home. I think Home Again is a new episode, which we did not get to.
Okay.
Because our friend bailed on us.
Yeah.
In Home Again, Mulder claims tulpa is a theosophist mistranslation of tulku. This is so Mulder. Classic Mulder. Yeah. And that it has no basis in Tibetan Buddhism. Whereas in Arcadia, he identified the Ubermensch as being a tulpa, a Tibetan thought form. The tulpa is, in fact, a very old concept in Tibetan Buddhism, entirely separate from tulku.
Okay, so, but I said it exactly what I meant.
It's an imaginary will for, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. An imaginary friend that's been willed.
You're just out here in these streets quoting Fox Mulder.
I'm a very bright person.
I don't know if I follow them or just, like, because I keep liking the tweets. Twitter keeps serving me the tweets. But there's an account that basically just reposts things from Tumblr of people just being like, what is the X-Files? And, like, just, like basically, like, alien cops, but, like, it's just, like, misunderstanding. Or it's always pictures of, like, Mulder saying something crazy, Scully being like, what? And then him explaining, then her just going like, I love it. Every single time.
Yeah.
It's a show that's purest form.
All right. Read Meg's email.
We have a lottery, or we have a lottery address. We have an email address, lottery@cageclub.me. Meg's reaction to The Shame. I thought that this book was okay. Also, writing about any book, not just this book. I thought that this book was okay. I'm not talking to you, Meg. I'm talking to anybody else. Meg writes in about every book. But I liked it more as I wrote this email. So this is actually the reverse of next episode.
It's a twisty-turny.
I would have liked it better if it was longer. More specifically, I felt there was a lack of consequences in the book that felt missing. The biggest example is that she just comes home after being gone for 24 hours to nothing. And honestly, well, there's kind of a non-ending, but I kind of like the non-ending. We didn't talk about the ending.
I like a non-ending. You know me.
Honestly, Egg writes, I would have been fine if there was a scene of forgiveness or anger, just something. I also don't know if we ever learned about the fallout of her cutting the Dean's steak at that dinner. I don't think it's actually fallout. It seems like that's actually an interesting scene where she's at, like, a dinner party with all of her husband's work friends. And it seems like she is both the life of the party and also the most embarrassing person in the history of the world. And it all seems fine.
Do you know how much I relate to that exact sentiment?
Sure.
Where it's like, I'm just like, I'm the funniest, but all no, I'm the worst. Ah, mm-hmm. I live. That's like.
Well, I will once again reference Live Log 2.
Yeah.
And Megan Boyle, after she has like a gathering of friends who like aren't her best friends, but sometimes even her best friends, she like list her social faux pas. She's like, these are all the things I did at the party that I did not think went well. And then at the end, she's just like, but it's probably fine.
There's so many times when I think that I'm killing it, and then I go home and I'm just like, oh my God. Oh my God. How did I? That happens more at work than it does. Like, I don't give a fuck if like you or Tom or Matt or like that was embarrassing. You know, that doesn't matter to me. If I'm like with.
You're also often like leaning into that there anyway.
Yeah, for sure.
But like when you're doing neurosurgery, you're like, you should be cracking jokes, but sometimes you crack jokes. You're like, oh, I shouldn't have said that.
Is it canon that I'm a neurosurgeon?
It is now.
Okay.
How is your comic book going about the alligator man in Iowa? I felt like the part where she talks about the Jewish professor, she had said that voice is a crutch and all you need in the novel is, quote, drama, was talking directly about the way this book is written. Because at its core, I felt that there was no actual drama because you don't get any real reactions from anyone else. And in a way, it's kind of beautiful because you have a mother who is forcing the reader to be her audience, not let the reader be a voyeur in her life.
Yeah, it's a very solipsistic novel. We can reward solipsism when it's in the service of feminism and things like that, because it's like when you've denied a group of people a sense of self for a long enough time, selfishness becomes something that we can say, like, be a little selfish as a treat.
Doesn't it kind of also fit the like trapped audience that isn't there, your tulpa, if you will, of like being trapped in motherhood and being like, well, now that I have you and you can't escape, it's like she's not actually talking to anybody. She's just like stuck with her own thoughts, but like we are subject to our own thoughts.
I suppose so. What is the...
All in all, a pretty good novel. I'd be interested to read makenna Goodman's next one.
I was thinking about that, like the stuff with... Because I have an MFA, so like I've been in a lot of workshops and things like that. Well, you know, I got it concurrently with my... MD, my residency in neurosurgery. Mm-hmm. Why did you put that on me? You know, like Ben Carson, you know, Ben Carson, mm-hmm. the neurosurgeon, mm-hmm. Ben Carson, who's famously separated the conjoined twins who are connected at the head. That's like his, mm-mm. that's like his claim to fame. Like he was the first person to ever like separate conjoined twins who were connected at the head. And that's why he was like the world's most famous neurosurgeon.
Really?
Yeah.
There is. I just rewatched Marge versus the Monorail, and there's a conjoined twins. Do you remember the conjoined joke?
No.
So the monorail's going out of control at the end. They're like, get an anchor. And they're just cutting through all the town that like everything's getting sliced apart. And Dr. Hibber is with these conjoined twins. He goes, it's a very slow and painful operation. It just goes zip.
Like, yeah. I do.
They high five and they walk off.
Yeah.
Pretty good.
But the point of my Ben Carson story is that both of them died.
How long after the surgery?
I don't know, but it's like, I could have done that. Like, his book about himself is titled Gifted Hands. It's like, yeah, I don't know, man. I don't think so. Anybody could have done that. I'm sure it seemed really hard at the time, but the results are the same as if anyone else did it. So I have an MFA, and I've been in a lot of these workshop classes, obviously, where people are like, show, don't tell.
Yep.
Tell, don't show. And I like thought, I think you're supposed to think that his advice is douchey, but I found his advice. I think his advice is good advice.
Which is, all I can think about right now is Ben Carson.
I mean, me too. Putin is a one horse country. Oil. Do you remember that?
No.
That's his, like, they gave him the Republican debates.
Like in 2016?
In 2016. Yeah. They give everyone like a final like statement to make. Mm-hmm. And so people go one by one down the thing and they get to Ben Carson and Ben Carson just goes, Putin is a one horse country, oil. He was combining the idea of a one horse town mm-hmm. with a one trick pony and it mashed together into Putin is a one horse country, oil.
Well, that reminds me of, I finished watching Reform and there's the guy who was just like, he's trying to do like fools rush in where angels fear to tread. And he's just like, he's trying to get people to take their seats. And he's just like, angels tread and fools rush to your seats. And John Boyce is just like, what?
Yeah.
Anyway. Yeah. You were saying,
I don't
whose
know.
Advice?
We forget it.
Email and lottery at Cage Club. I mean, keep reading.
Oh, fuck. Beat me to it. Today's crime is illegally discarding the battery.